So we are launching now on a big voyage, you see, through the oceans of life. We have done the subtle matter, Canto 1, the worst year of Book 2, then the first entry into the cosmic dimension is in the world of subtle matter. Now, from subtle matter, Ashwapati is moving into the world of life. It's a huge, big ocean life with many pockets, with many colors, with many depths, with many heights also, you see. Running into 5-6 cantos, actually, in all. The entire description about life in various aspects of life, 5-6 aspects of life, you see. Now, this canto, I have already sent you the statistics, but then we'll quickly see them again. This canto has 4 sections, 32, 33, 34, 35. 5 sections, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 5 sections. Now, the total number of sentences in this canto is 135, and the total number of lines, 538 lines. So, a fairly long canto by itself, 538 lines, is it? Now, the section which we are going to do is section 32, the first section of the canto. It has 23 sentences and 90 lines. So, it's a relatively short section. Relatively short section, but it is a very disturbing kind of section also. It starts with that, you see. It's a disturbing section. There is something tragic, something sad, as if about the beginning of the worlds of life, you see. Now, the very first line tells you that an uneven broad sand now lived his feet. Each word here is kind of weighed with enormous content in it. This is an uneven word, uneven ascent. This is a broad ascent, and his feet are lured into this uneven domain, you see, lured. Now, the word lewd appears about 20 times in Savitri, in all. Here it could be attractive, charming, trapping, things like that, you see. Now, it is lewd here, in this particular section here, is not in the sense of getting attracted and charmed and trapped somewhere. But there is a sort of a natural urge to move in this direction. And his feet are lewd, you see. That is what it means. His feet are lewd, you see. Means he is going to walk. Now, the earlier description at the end of the canto 5 of the previous book, we had a long description of the sailor on the oceans of time. So that gave a sort of an immediate impression as if the entire process is a flat voyage on the surface of a sea. But here the description is of oceans, one above the other, the climbing oceans. They are not on a flat surface, on a globe surface also at one place. They are climbing, the oceans are climbing one above the other constantly, you see. This ocean, that ocean, that ocean. So, now the image, the metaphor is, so to say, slowly changing from voyage on the surface of a sea to the ascent on the slopes of heaven. Ascending slopes of heaven, you see, climbing. So, ascent, he starts with the ascent word, ascent with that purpose, you see. And he says, uneven. Sometimes it is happy, sometimes it is sad. Sometimes it is fortunate, sometimes it is misfortunate. Sometimes it is evil, sometimes it is good. Sometimes it is truthful, sometimes it is false. So, all these things are kind of now coming into his view in the next vein after the world of subtle matter. The world of subtle matter was basically a perfect figure and a perfect frame. A perfect figure in a perfect frame. It was a kind of a frozen image of beauty. And that frozen image of beauty, well, after all, it's a typal world, so it is a frozen thing, it is fixed in a certain sense. So, it is a beauty, but then there is no life in that, there is no throb in that, there is no vivacity in that. See, I mean, you admire a statue, you may admire for hours and hours and hours, but finally you kind of get tired of it, watching it also, you see. You want that statue to speak to you, dance with you, move with you, win battles, defeat, get defeats and that kind of a thing. You want that sort of a thing with the statue. So, that is not there in the world of subtle matter. You see, subtle matter is a prototypal world for producing or for getting forms which will precipitate down on the earth eventually. See. Now, therefore, Ashwapati was not very happy with that in that sense, you see. And therefore, he is coming back now into a world. His lure is there, that lure because of that purpose. We had our spirit tires of being surfaces. That is what we had in the world of subtle. It gets tired. Transcended is the splendor of the form. It turns to hidden powers and deeper states. Our spirit's urge is there. It is not happy with only surface forms. So now he looked beyond for greater light. Ashwapati's urge is there, his urge is there, his look is there. So, in that sense, naturally, he is kind of lured into a new world there. His soul's peak climb, abandoning in its rear, this brilliant courtyard, the house of days, brilliant courtyard. Yes, the world of subtle matter is brilliant, beautiful, very perfect, very geometric, structured, that sort of a thing. But then that is not sufficient for his demand. See, what is his demand? After all, will that sort of a frozen perfection be able to bring about a change in the earth nature? His test, whether it is good or bad, whether it is acceptable or not acceptable, his constant test is whether that will do something good for the earth. So, he will judge every aspect of his travel, of his movement, of his progress, of his evolution also, in terms of its good for the soul of the earth. So, that is a test constantly, you see. And in that sense, it's a very scientific way of questing the truth for which you are really moving, you see, which you want to have, you see. So, now he looked beyond for greater light, his soul speak, climb. Peak climb, abandoning is rare, this brilliant courtyard of dream. He left that fine material paradise. Yes, it's a paradise, very beautiful one, structured on that day. His destiny lay beyond larger space. No, this will not be enough for me, for my soul, for my demand, for my mission to be fulfilled. This is not sufficient for me. Yes, it is good. What is acceptable, I will accept that thing and bring it to the earth. But then, that does not satisfy my full demand for the soul of the earth. And therefore, I must move on, you see. Now here he is destinally beyond in large space. Destiny is Ashwapati governed by destiny? Is his voice governed by destiny? He is destiny. Or he is going to mold his own destiny. He is going to shape his own destiny. You see. This is the difference. Here he is destinally beyond in larger sphere. In the world, it is not that somebody is imposing something on him from above. In a certain sense, there is an imposition of the highest nature from him. Yes, Ashwapati, you are here in this mortal world for this, this, this. You have to do this, this, this. In that sense, there is a sort of ambition in him. But that is not destiny. That is a mission which he has to fulfill it. But now, through the processes of existence here, he has to make movement and then shape his own destiny, his own future, his own progress. So, he is destiny. He is molding his destiny. He is shaping his destiny. He is creating his own destiny. And the entire test lies whether that thing is going to be useful to the earth or not. So, in fact, that is a very firm focus. That is the pivot of the whole thing. Whether whatever I do is good for the soul of the earth or not, that is the determinative factor. That is the determinative factor. And if it is good, well, welcome. Otherwise, I am not interested in you. You may be great, grand, etc., etc., but of no value to me at all. My purpose is the soul of the earth, you see. So, that is the whole thing now. So, it is in that sense, he is lewd to something else, you see. And uneven. So, uneven, I said, there are alterations, good, bad, etc., constantly in this new world into which he is entering, you see. There is a calm sea, then suddenly there is thunder and hurricane and tempest and storm on the sea. So, all these things keep on constantly happening in this sea of life. In fact, the Sanskrit word for life is jivana. Jivana means water, the flow, which is constantly flowing, which is not steady, which does not stand at one place. The stream is constantly moving, changing its shape, form, structures and moving on. That is life, that is jivana, you see. So, that way, he is really, it is really an uneven state of existence, of consciousness itself, of this life. An uneven, broad ascent, now nude his feet, now after his visit to the subtle matter, now he is now into his feet. Now here, see the beauty of Savitri as poetry is in the skill of the artist that the poet is. Each word, each value, it is not only the sense which is important in Savitri, but the aspects of a picture, the aspect of music, of sound, of rhythm, they are perhaps more important than just the sense. The whole thing. See, an uneven ascent now lived his feet would have been enough for me. As far as sense is concerned, why broad? Why broad? You see, from the point of view of poetry, why broad? You see. Now, but the whole line changes miraculously with one single adjective, broad. Remove that broad, and the line becomes very flat, very insipid, you see. An uneven ascent. Now, lewd his feet, the music is not there, the charm is not there, see. Do you see the difference between these two? Do you feel the difference? Is it not so? An uneven ascent, now lewd his feet, an uneven broad ascent, now lewd his feet. Suddenly, it is an expansion, widening of the whole thing. So, that is the art of Savitri. And you see the quality of poetry in terms of these. Otherwise, broad is not just added for the sake of adding, you see. Metrically, broad is not required. Metrically, the line would have been I am his feet. It would have been like that, you see, without broad, you see. But with this one, an unaved, unbrought to am, to an apex, you see, to an apex. Ascend, I am. Now lute, spondy, his feet, I am. So, see, the rhythmic changes are very magical, you see, in the whole process, you see. One single word, the whole thing changes completely. Now, of course, you cannot change that word broad. Even if you want to put some other adjective, that wouldn't do. If I say uneven, large, tall, high, ascent began, it will not do. It will not do. See, you can't even have an uneven, uplifting ascent, soaring ascent. It won't do at all. It has to be broad, you see. So that is the art of poetry, that is the art of Savitri. Srivandu is a master poet. I mean, you have to see these nuances of Savitri's poetry from that angle, see. Normally, we go by the sense, by the content, by what kind of meaning we can make. But the other aspect of poetry is not really attended to at all. I mean, we have got any number of commentaries, any number of lectures, any number of talks and all that kind of thing. But the aspect of poetry, in that sense, is not really visualized in the presentations, you see. An uneven, broad ascent, now lewd his feet.